لا إله إلا الله إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستهديه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فهو المهتدي ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. My dear brothers and my sisters, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. In this world, we have missed a great opportunity to portray Islam to the people around us as it ought to be. Al-Islam is a universal religion by the Quran and by the Sunnah. But today, when you look at the world in which we live today, Islam has become a sectarian. It has become a country-related. Muslims today, we are too much wasting so much energy about talking about Islam at a very individualistic level. It's a country, it's a tribe, it's a group of people. When Islam, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made it clear, is a religion for mankind. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when you look in Surah Al-Baqarah, the very first command that He ever established for mankind is Ya ayyuha an-nas. It's a call on mankind as a whole. اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم والذين من قبلكم لعلكم تتقون. اتقوا. Allah calls every single human. In Surah An-Nisa, يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة. In another surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells to Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم, قل يا أيها الناس. Tell to people that I have been sent as a messenger to you all. So when Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was sent, he was not sent to Quraysh and to Mecca or to anyone else. He was sent to all mankind anywhere in the entire galaxy, anywhere where they are. So where did we go wrong? Why has Islam become such a thin kind of a religion? Today it's only us. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about women in Al-Quran, He doesn't speak about women in Saudi Arabia or Iran. He talks about women in the entire world. When He sets a law, it's for mankind. It's not for a group of people. Today, unfortunately, Islam has been so restricted that we think it's only for us. It's only halal for us, haram. And whenever it talks about other people, it only talks about them as being kuffar. That's it. So the relation between Islam and them is a relation of disbelief. But is that really what it is? The whole purpose of why Islam is not a universal religion today, why it's not people, why they are not taking advantage of it, why mankind is not enjoying Islam, the primary guilty people is us. And how does that come to us? By this. Look, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala introduced, when Allah wanted to deputize Musa alayhi salam as a messenger, what did he do? He was with his wife and family, and then he saw a fire. قَالَ لِأَهْلِهِمْ كُثُوا. Sit down here. إِنِّي آنَسْتُ نَارًا. I have seen a fire and I feel safety and I need to go there to get some direction. When he came there, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala introduced himself to him. يا موسى إني أنا ربك فاخلع عليك إنك بالوادي المقدس طوى. Allah introduced himself. I am your Rabb. Because Musa عليه السلام knew who Allah was in his religion. And then further Allah introduced him and he said إني أنا الله. And then he introduced الرب, the Lord, and then he introduced the divine to be worshipped. إني أنا الله وأقيم الصلاة لذكري. And then he said establish a salat to mention my name. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brings Musa and talks to him one-to-one. Do you think Allah will use or will give the message to the last of the messages, to the best of all the messages, to the one whose message will comprehend and close the chain of prophets, just like that, read in the name of your Rabb, Iqra bismi Rabbik, the one who has created a man from a alaqa, they did translate it into a clot of blood. Read and your Lord is the honorable. He taught man with the pen, that which he didn't know. That's it. This is like to the man. Because we Muslims, and when you look in the books of tafsir, you find like really strange thing. Somebody has someday translated a meaning or explained the meaning of an ayah. 14 centuries later, we are still living on his meaning. That is a great problem. We don't understand Iqra. We all take Iqra as read. When in fact Allah didn't mean that. The message of, and to understand why Allah chose these five ayat from Surah Al-Alaq. Five. Why didn't Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala choose any other ayat? Why did He choose these particular words to reveal them to the Prophet? Why did He give him the title of a prophet with these words? When you look externally, these words are far less than how Allah introduced Himself to Musa. And when you look at it, Allah introduces Himself to Musa, right? It's a big job. And to Muhammad, He sends Jibreel. It should be the other way around. So what are we missing? I'll tell you. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala one day called the angels, وَإِذْ قَالَ رَبُّكَ لِلْمَلَائِكَةِ إِنِّي جَاعِلٌ فِي الْأَرْضِ خَلِيفًا. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told the angels that I am going to create on earth a khalifa. Khalifa is the one that succeeds. You produce children, the children, and also the job of this khalifa is to establish the commands and the laws of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The angels, they said what they said. I want to get right to our father Adam alayhi salam. وَعَلَّمَ آدَمَ الْأَسْمَاءَ كُلَّهَا. Allah taught Adam alayhi salam all the nouns. Al-ism in Arabic has got two meanings, both of which are extremely beautiful. One, as-sumu, and that is the highness, the loftiness of the status, and the other one is the mark. سَنَسِمُهُ عَلَى الْخُرْطُونَ. As-sima is the mark that you leave, the brand that you leave on a person. So your name, if it's a beautiful name, it will make raise your status, and it will only mark you. Your name is X, and your name is X. It doesn't know other person already. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made, then He taught Adam alayhi salam everything, the names of everything. Then what did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala do? Then He brought all what Allah taught him. For example, if Allah taught our father Adam alayhi salam how to say computer, then Allah brought the computer in front of the malaika and He says, Ambi'uni. In the Arabic, the term Ambi'uni is not akhbir, is not about inform me. An-naba in Arabic is not like inform me, tell me. It's not like that. An-naba is when you tell something about the unseen. Because if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had shown a computer to the angels back then, there was no computer. There were no cars. There were nothing. So the angels would have to know the future. They couldn't. Why? Because Allah didn't give them the tool to find out what that is there. That tool, Allah speaks about it when He revealed it to Rasulullah and says, I will explain. So here we have an equation. A human being that knows everything. Angels that know nothing of the two words. That when Allah taught our father Adam, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala started that messenger, He opened the parenthesis. Who closed the parenthesis? Our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But what was the parenthesis that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam closed and that we are not getting? That parenthesis is the soul of Islam. If we understand it, our life would change. We all know that in Sahih al-Bukhari, in Muslim al-Sahihain, as Ummuna Khadija radiallahu anha said that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, before he became a prophet, he used to see visions. He used to walk in the mountains, walk in Mecca, and he would hear rocks saying, As-salamu alayka ya Rasulullah. As-salamu alayka ya Rasulullah. Few times Jibreel alayhi salam would appear to him, and not as an angel, but a human being. He said to him, Ya Muhammad, you are Rasulullah, and I am Jibreel. In preparation. Then Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam started enjoying being alone. He would go to Ghar Hira, spend time, seclusion. I don't want to talk to the world, I want to be by myself. For a whole month before that, and that was the month of Ramadan, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was by himself. Now I want you to imagine, that night of the night of the 25th, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was going to appoint Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam as a prophet. What happened? He was in the dark. Suddenly a human being appears to him. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was no chicken. Yet you are surprised. The angel or the man tells him, Iqra. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam didn't read. It's like you go to someone who doesn't have food and you tell him, eat. You're making fun of him or what? But this is not like that. Allah tells him, Iqra. What would Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Iqra? If it was about reading, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam would have told him, look, you know I don't trade. Why are you asking me to do something I cannot do? What do you have in mind? But Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam didn't say that. He qal, ma ana biqari. I am not one of the readers, as they translated in the everything. That, like, this is the norm of what they say there. Now, but the rest of the ayat, it tells you, اقرأ باسم ربك الذي خلق. اقرأ with the name of your Rabb that has created. Okay, this is reading and this is creation. And then, okay, خلق الإنسان من علق. He created man from a suspended. This is if you translate, العلق is suspended. And then they go, now it's the cloth of the blood that hangs onto the womb. No, you're driving me nuts or what? This is the first message. This is the first contact from a divine to a mankind to tell him you're a prophet. He's not going to tell him something that Rasulullah wouldn't understand, right? How would you understand? And then he says, اقرأ وربك الأكرم. Read, and your Rabb is the most generous. Okay? علم بالقلم علم الإنسان ما لم يعلم. He taught with the pen, and he taught man that which he didn't know. You're talking to a man who's completely ignorant. He doesn't know. He's illiterate. He doesn't. And you're telling him about the opposite. This is the version. But is it really what Allah meant with these five ayat? Well, in fact, it's not. The word iqra in Arabic has more than a meaning. And this is the beauty of Arabic. It's a comprehensive meaning. It is read. If I give you a piece of paper, you read iqra, you read. You can also read from something that you have memorized. But there is a third term that we have not paid attention to. When Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or in Arabic we say, أَقْرِئْهُ السَّلَامُ أَقْرِئْهُ السَّلَامُ. أَقْرِئْ is means convey to him my salam, pass my salam to them. This is what is meant. It's not read, because Rasulullah doesn't read. And it's not recite out of your mind, because Rasulullah couldn't. So iqra here is what? Convey. Iqra, convey. Rasulullah ﷺ says, understood exactly what Jibreel meant. Convey. Take this message to others. Rasulullah ﷺ, ما أنا بقارئ. I don't have. What do you want me to convey? What can I convey? What can I? Jibreel told him, اقرأ mean convey بسم ربك with the name of your Rabb. You are a messenger of your Rabb. The job that you gotta convey is what? The name of your Rabb. Rasulullah says, okay. So now it no longer is about reading, it's about giving da'wah. Give da'wah to the rest of the world, and when you do it, don't call them for yourself, call them for the Rabb. He didn't say اقرأ بسم الله. What did he say بربك? Because the covenant that Allah took upon us mankind, قال ألست بربكم. Am I not your Rabb? We all said yes, you are our. So this is reminding us of the covenant. Who told the angel I am creating? Was it Allah or the Rabb? إذ قال ربك للملائكة. It's the Rabb that spoke. So it only is a matter of logic that the Rabb speaks. So what is the difference between al-ilah and al-Rabb? Why does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala choose to use al-ilah, and why does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala choose to use al-Rabb? There is a great difference. Al-ilah, he doesn't do. He only speaks, commands, and you worship him. That's the God. That's al-ilah. Al-Rabb, he doesn't speak. He only does. He only does. I'll give you an example. In Surah Maryam, when Maryam alayhi salam gave birth to Jesus, when she came, وَأَتَتْ قَوْمَهَا تَحْمِلُهُ, she came with her baby in her hand. قَالُوا يَا مَرْيَمُ, how did you come with this thing? قَالْتْ إِنِّي نَذَرْتُ لِلرَّحْمَانِ صَوْمًا فَلَنْ أُكَلِّمَ الْيَوْمَ إِنْسَانًا. I have dedicated today a fasting to the Rahman. I am not going to speak. And the root of fast, a sawm, is when you don't talk. And then they apply this on not eating, not doing things. She, when she spoke that one, it was a Rabb who defended Maryam. How did he do it? He made Isa speak. He made Isa speak. But for Aisha radiallahu anha, when she was accused of fornication, who defended her? It was not the Rabb. It was Allah. That's why he issued commands to say that she was innocent. If it was a Rabb who would have proven that she was not guilty, guess what would have happened? Her body would have spoken and say, I haven't done it. This is why the Rabb and al-ilah, Allah, when Allah in the Quran uses the term Rabb, it has a complete different meaning. Why are Abdullah and Abdul Rahman, why are they the most beloved names to Allah? Do you know why? I'll tell you why. Because Abdullah refers to Allah, to the worship. Ar-Rahman is the name of the Rabb. Allah is the name of the God of who that we worship. Ar-Rahman is the name of the Rabb that gives us. That is why they are beloved to Him. Abdullah, the one Allah we worship. Abdul Rahman is the Rabb that gives us. This is why when you make dua, we say, Ya Rabbi. We don't say, Ya Allah gave us. Allah doesn't give you. If you want your dua to be accepted, use the word Rabb. And if you want to be smart and get really your dua to be accepted, call him by his name. Ar-Rahman, Ya Rahman, Ya Rahman. That you're calling him by his name. So when Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala told al-malaika, inni ja'ilun fil ardi khalifa, I'm going to bring, put on earth a man that is going to succeed and there is knowledge involved. When Rasulullah's time came, guess what did Allah do? He closed the bracket that he opened at the time of Adam. What was that bracket? Iqra, convey, give da'wah in the name of your Rabb. Iqra bismi rabbika alladhi khalaq. The khalq, they always translate it to creation. But actually it doesn't mean creation, it means design. Because before you create, you need to design. Before you make a clothes, you have to cut it and prepare it. Before you make a computer, you need to design it. And the creation bringing it to life, الَّذِي قَدَّرَ الَّذِي خَلَقَ فَسَوَّى وَالَّذِي قَدَّرَ فَهَدَى خَلَقَ فَسَوَّى. التَّسْوِيَة in Arabic is the creation, making it something that you touch. الخلق is when it is only a design, not a creation. So when it came to Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم, اقرأ باسم ربك الذي خلق خلق الإنسان من علق. العلق, it's not the cloth that they say, no. العلق comes from the term علاقة, it's relationship. The plural of علاقة is علاقات, relations. When I have multiple relations with somebody, like with your mother, your brother, things like that, the multiple, the plural of علاقات is علق, is علق. What this means is الذي خلق الإنسان من علق, meaning with a group of relationships. Your eyes have relationships with each other. They have relationship with your brain. Your tongue has relationship with the world. With this, when you fall sick with the tongue, suddenly the whole body is sick. There is an infinity of relationship inside us humans. It doesn't mean the cloth of the blood that they said. It means the infinity of relationships within us humans. Every human is created with an infinity of relations. There is not a single human that was not created without this. And this is where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, خَلَقَ الْإِنسَانَ مِنْ عَلَقٍ, with an infinity of relationship. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, اِقْرَأْ وَرَبُّكَ الْأَكْرَمُ, meaning convey what you are going to be taught of Al-Quran and Al-Islam. And Allah Al-Kareem has got more than a meaning. One of them is the generous. The second one is the precious, the most expensive. We say, Ahjar Karima, precious stones, rocks. This is gems and pearls and emeralds and things like that. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is generous and at the same time is the most precious. Iqra rabbuka al-akram, alladhi 'allama, the one who has taught. Go back to Adam. Go back to Adam. Because this is Rasulullah SAW closes the gap, the parenthesis of all prophets. This is why after Rasulullah SAW there is no messenger, no prophet to come. Because every single prophet that came before him, he was given strict laws, do and don't. We Muslims today, as we are today, we are the best people because Allah gave us an expendable set of laws that we can apply them until the end of time. Why? Because we go back to the father Adam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave our father Adam all the knowledge, and the Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam came to teach us all that knowledge. عَلَّمَ بِالْقَلَمِ. Al-qalam is not the pen that you write with. Al-qalam in Arabic, we say قَلَّمَ الْأَشْجَارِ. قَلَّمَ الْأَشْجَارِ meaning he differentiated, he depicted it, he emphasized the trees when you catch the branches and everything. Al-qalam is to differentiate between things. عَلَّمَ بِالْقَلَمِ, i.e. Allah teaches mankind with differentiations. Meaning if you want to study Arabic, you have to differentiate between this and this. If you want to study mechanics, you have to differentiate between what's an engine. If you have to study medicine, you have to differentiate. It's not with the pen. You use the pen to document, but you use the science to differentiate. This is why Allah has given us five senses. The hands, the touch, the smell, the breathing, the eyes. Every one of them is an element of qalam to differentiate. عَلَّمَ بِالْقَلَمِ. Is there anyone on earth that can learn without really differentiating between what they are learning or not? No way. And that's why Allah SWT says, عَلَّمَ بِالْقَلَمِ عَلَّمَ الْإِنسَانَ آدَمَ عَلَيْهِ السَّلَامِ مَا لَمْ يَعْلَمْ. If Allah didn't teach Adam عليه السلام, man would never have known. And today, whatever knowledge we get to, only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has that knowledge, infinity of it. Without Allah, we didn't learn. So now, when you understand, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent Jibreel to Rasulullah with the term Iqra, convey, you understand that this is the last message. This is the last message on earth. We Muslims today, we made the whole five precious ayat that broke the ages of darknesses into reed. And the man created it from a cloth of blood and used the pen. Nonsense. Nonsense! For 14 centuries, the Muslims have been on this. The only time they took out of this is when the Muslims start inventing and becoming proactive people, good doers. That's when we applied the faith, the five ayat. So today, my job is not only to read, is to convey to the world, be part of a successful team called Help Mankind Take the Divine Knowledge that Allah gave to our father Adam. Rasulullah ﷺ, only miracle on earth today is the Qur'an, and the Qur'an is the root of all roots of knowledge. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله لي لكم واستغفروا إنه هو الغفور الرحيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على نبينا المختار صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. We have a question here, my dear brothers and my sisters. Why isn't there a tafsir of Rasulullah for the Quran? He could have sat down with the Sahaba. He's lived 23 years. Jibreel alayhi salam was there. Rasulullah could have dictated a tafsir of the whole Quran. But why didn't he do it? Why didn't Abu Bakr write books like today? We've got so many books. Why didn't the Sahaba write books? Why? The reason why they didn't do it, especially Rasulullah, why didn't he make tafsir? Because Al-Quran is the book of Allah. Allah is alive today. The book of Allah are the words of Allah. They are alive. And they talk to alive people. The reason why Rasulullah didn't translate or explain the Quran, because if he explained it, he would have killed it. The meaning would always stay there. But Allah didn't want that. The Quran is progressive. Each generation must understand Al-Islam, Al-Quran, based on the knowledge that Allah has given them. But what happened to us today, many of our scholars have done that. They took us to an Islam written in the year 300 of the 3rd century. And until today, we are only living on what Ibn Kathir says, what Ibn Jarir al-Tabari said, and what that scholar said. We don't have brains. We have to think and look at the Quran, how they looked at it 700 years ago. Doesn't make sense. This Quran is an alive book. It's a live book. Talks to people that are alive so that they apply it in their life. This is our problem today. It's because we do not follow the rule. Allah opened a parenthesis when He created Adam alayhi salam and taught him the names of everything. And when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala closed that parenthesis by teaching Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam what He has taught our father Adam, and it's up to us to convey that. And we have today scholars, they tell you Islam is only what this scholar said, what that scholar said, and what this scholar said. And they threw everything else out of the window. This is the root of our problem. I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to guide us to the right guidance and to make us of those who understand the message of Allah as Allah wants it, not as that scholar wants it or the other scholar wants it. The Quran is the book of Allah. Learn Arabic. Learn to speak to it. It's an unbelievable book. It is an unbelievable book. وصلى الله على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين والحمد لله رب العالمين وأقم الصلاة.